So, a little bit about my background, which won't really be part of this talk directly, but possibly informs it, is, so I got involved doing computer music very early, but for a very brief time. When I was first in college, there was a PDP-11, and I made a piece, but the fan noise was so horrible, I avoided computers in favor of my own either analog electronics or electronics I made myself until I got out of graduate school. And that was the point of the single board microcomputer. But I did some projects that way. And then a very good friend of mine, David Anderson, if you've ever heard of SETI at home, this screensaver for doing SETI calculations, that's one of his projects. He's a computer scientist. Anyway, it happened, we were both working with a kind of cult programming language at the time called Forth, with the same hardware, so we began to collaborate. And we did a whole series of real-time computer music systems under the name Formula. This is all the land and time of MIDI. I used that for quite a while into the late 90s, and then I became very interested in Super Collider, which is in many ways very similar, and it's a highly extensible environment. You can mess with the language, so you can make musical abstractions with the language. And so that's kind of my trajectory in music technology. Today, what I'm talking about is really more in the realm of, in a sense, it's aesthetics, but with technology very much involved. And it's very much taking to heart this question that Georgina Bourne sets up in this book, Music, Sound, and Space, where she, and my computer will continue to boot and reboot, it'll take it a little while. This comes from the school, and they've added so much protective software that it just doesn't know what it's doing when it first boots. It's amazing. And I ask about this, and they just look at me with vague impatience. Oh, you just don't understand. I said, well, I'd like my computer to work the first time. So the question is this. Now, you can think at the end of World War II, there's this moment where there's a kind of opening of possibilities through technology. You can think of, okay, later. I mean, first Pierre Schaeffer saying the idea of using, of music concrete, the idea of electronische music. Then by the end of the 50s, you have the Phillips Pavilion, the poem Electronique, this idea of an environment. Okay. And there's a whole trajectory where all this work is made, and it's made at the high end of research and engineering. So in the United States, you have an engineer at Bell Labs. Bell Labs, the telephone company, has its own monopoly on telephone systems. Has a special role as a research institute, does Telstar, and artists are able to insinuate themselves in and get them to help make projects. So there's this whole period of the high research moment in experimental music, or in computer music, or in contemporary music. Oh yes, in that time in Bell Labs, there'd be a flame war, if I can use that expression, in a research reports between Max Matthews and Billy Kluver. Max Matthews beginning music, 1, 2, and 3. Billy Kluver involved in performance environments, and they would have these little, kind of engineering battles. Only of historical interest. But now something happens by the end of the 70s, which is electronics becomes a consumer item. And I think you can mark it with the advent of MIDI, the advent of the DX7, so suddenly, the fruits of research become omnipresent, and that changes the terms upon which work can happen. So, for example, an example I like to use is Morton Sabotnik. Okay, so early analog synthesis, Buchla system makes wonderful percussion sounds that are quite unique at that moment to his music, and then of course they become presets. So the language that he painfully evolves is essentially taken away from him or given over to everyone. So I'm interested in asking questions about that kind of transition, but now I'm thinking about this in terms of right now. So I watch my daughter, who's 12, go onto YouTube and find different cultural practices that she then engages in. So it's not passive. It's very much a learning, it's an instructional tool. In fact, I tried to convince, unsuccessfully, a composition seminar I was doing, I wanted everybody to make the notation, write a piece where the notation entirely took the form of instructional videos for YouTube. I mean, I actually think you guys should do this. I think it's very interesting, the question of, well, okay, how can you give over a piece into that context? And how could that then potentially radicalize them? So this got me thinking about this question of what I would call performance vernaculars. Sorry, maybe you, I wouldn't really call it a folk music. I mean, that doesn't make any sense, or a folk art form. But there are all of these emergent creative practices in networked media online. And so I want to think about them in some way, to ask the question of how can I as an artist intervene or contribute or work within that framework. So to do this, I began looking and I began noticing that many artistic practices, different pieces or ideas or projects, end up being recapitulated in YouTube. Done by other people, possibly differently, sometimes explicitly in relation to that artwork, sometimes not. So I can't think of the, why on earth? Let's just see here. Oh, maybe it's just not, oh, I see. You see, you can say the little security thing, it's taking it 5 minutes to wake up, the pleasures of the bureaucratic state. So there's a video artist, Joan Logue, who's actually based in France now, who in the early 80s did this series of video portraits. And there's a particularly spectacular video portrait of John Cage that lasts 30 minutes, and the camera is simply on his face, and he's simply looking at the camera. And he's looking quite impassively, and then very, very slowly, over about 5 minutes, he begins to smile. And then equally slowly, the smile fades away. He's a good performer. I mean, and you know, it's a spectacular take. Well, there's a whole genre of videos online. What's this going to take? That do this kind of thing, where you've got a guy sort of sitting there, sort of doing an extended selfie. But video selfie. There's also a category of unintended video selfies where people are using their cameras and don't quite understand. Oh, it got there and then I killed it. That was my fault. Maybe it was. It came to life. So this is, we're not there yet. So this would be an example of that. Incidentally, there was an earlier video piece, a similar kind of video piece, where by an artist named Teddy Dibble, where he would ask his friends to make funny faces, but then hold them for a very long time, and like 10 minutes. And if you go and hold it for 10 minutes, your muscles strain and the thing becomes grotesque. Okay, so it moves, makes this transition, and he'd make video installations with these. Well, what you can say about these is these are examples of what people call participatory culture, where there's a low threshold to participation. And so I'm kind of interested in that space. Now, but to get started, and this is the part where I'm going to try to abbreviate this because it ends up being very much in a visual arts context, but will get us back to music, is I wanted to think through what I mean by experimentalism in relation to this. Okay, like, okay, so what on earth does that mean now? And I ended up doing this in relation to this article by Walter Van Michels called Neoliberal Aesthetics. And I'm not gonna read this, I'm gonna just sort of make a quick gestural foray. He uses this opposition of theatricality and absorption. So within the visual art domain, where he draws this from somebody named Michael Fried, this is a painting that is a painting discussed by Denise Diderot back in the 18th century. And he talks about how paintings of this sort, where you look and there's nothing addressing you, but instead it's completely contained in the image, that is somehow more satisfying. And that this is more interesting to him in the case of someone doing something than a still life, because there's this sense in which you just happen upon it as an image, just like you might happen upon someone in the library deeply engrossed in what they're doing. And they make this, there's this argument that in both art and music, in the 60s, sort of, there was this argument being made that, sort of out of modernism, that, an artwork true to its medium would have this property, this enclosure, this autonomy. And he makes this argument that what happens is, if you're, when they're seriously pursuing that, anything you do to intervene to shape will end up reading as theatrical. So his kind of riff, if you will, is to say that that makes the notion of chance composition, or 4 minutes and 33 seconds, makes Cage a solution to this dilemma as a quote-unquote absorptive artist. Now, I think this is wrong, incidentally. Let me just say, I'm going to argue against it. And the way I'm going to argue against it, I think you'll see how this could matter. But so recounting this argument. So here's an alternate, will it come up? Yes, yeah. Image. So this is of the Mies van der Rohe Foundation. So this beautiful architecture, but oops, there's somebody cleaning the window. And so another image of absorption. And part of the dialogue and the argument, Michael Fried looks at this and sees it as it's all about its self-enclosure. Rancière, the French philosopher, says, well, wait a minute, there's these other issues. Okay, because of course, you have somebody who's providing a service, service class, there's an economic discrepancy, there's a hierarchy, all of that is also co-present. And so there's this discussion about that issue. And for Rancière, he talks about images like this, of just an adolescent girl on Polish beach. Winnicky Dykstra, actually that's misspelled, there should be a J in there. Or this Walker Evans photo of a kitchen in Appalachia. It says two things happen. One is you can see these as formal compositions, but there's an excess that comes through as well. That this thing that's in a different hierarchical relationship culturally can manifest itself, can express itself, can be, can be aesthetic in some other way. And we can see how that this little argument echoes the question of receptivity to quote-unquote sounds as themselves, receptivity to environmental sound, noise versus tone, all the different ways in which musical projects of expanding the language, expanding the range of relations to sound, okay, echo this. Okay. What Walter Van Michels, it's too bad this kind of soft, it's a great photo. It's three almost identical photos of paparazzi taking pictures of something. And the point is, when you look at this, you just see, you don't see the object of attention, you just see all this feverish attention. So it's almost like a parody of absorption. And among other things, it's not a calm, reflective absorption, it's a distracted, agitated absorption. And the fact that it's in triplicate really brings to mind the fact that this is an image that will be replicated. These are images that will be replicated and diffused that are part of cable news, that are part of the media scheme. And the same artist makes pieces like this, which is rendered almost completely unseeable on the projector. I'll just turn this around. So what it is a photograph where the flash is rendered it almost invisible, but of a similar kind of happenstance event. So his argument, Walter Ben Michael's argument is, these have this formal closure. Okay, and that formal closure is the crucial property. And that the ability of things to manifest themselves in an image ends up being complicit with a neoliberal economy where, yes, there should be social rights, but discrepancies of wealth don't warrant consideration. As long as there's equality of opportunity, there's equality. So he tries to make this argument that while this other viewpoint, which would be, in a sense, touches on an experimentalist viewpoint, opens certain doors, it closes doors to political awareness. Okay, and why am I interested in this? Because now when I go over to YouTube and think about all these funny practices over here, that's one of the questions. Is, well, what is going on here and what is its political resonance or its apolitical resonance? What might that mean for a creative practice? Okay, now here's what I'm going to pull back. There's another writer, Brian Rotman. It's a beautiful book called Signifying Nothing. And this is about the introduction of the number zero in European mathematics, perspective, paper money.
Paper
money. And see, actually, interestingly, this is our moment of reverence for the neoliberal. It's easiest to talk about this, I think, in relation to money. When you have coin, where the metal is the value, and the image on the metal is simply to warrant its correctness, you can always cheat somebody by scraping some of the metal. So the coin, which seems substantive, is subject to variation. If I have paper money, there's nothing to scrape away. And what he argues is the problem with paper money is you can only understand its value if you think of it inside of a system of exchange. So it's what he calls a meta-signifier. Zero is the same way. If I have 1, 2, 3, 4, and so forth, okay? The idea of that is I can always make a correlation. 1 speaker, 2 speakers, 8 speakers, 16 speakers, 19 speakers. Okay, cool. Right, but 0 speakers. Well, why isn't it 0 microphones? Why isn't it 0 glasses, cups of espresso? It's too plentiful, right? So, and people literally had a hard time dealing with the concept of zero when it was first introduced. It took 100 years for it to be fully accepted within European mathematics. So he says it's this problem of meta-signification. Now, so I'm going to move quickly. So Las Meninas would be another example. So he talks about this in terms of viewpoint, where these images here, you're not just seeing the painting, you're seeing the artist seeing what he's painting. There are these multiple plays of representation. So the painting is commenting on itself. Now notice, this is completely different from the image of absorption because it leaks out. In the case of Las Meninas, the painter, come on, hello, you'll get there. It takes a long time because it's a big image. But you know Las Meninas, right? Here it is. No, it still isn't there. There it is. And so there's Velázquez, and is he looking at you, the viewer, or is he looking at the subjects of the painting that you see reflected in the mirror? Or is he doing both?
All of that becomes a play. So the whole play here is not one of an isolated absorption, but of something reaching out, but reaching it out in a way that reflects upon itself. Here is David Tudor doing 4 minutes and 33 seconds. And so my argument is this, okay, there's several things to say about that piece. One is, it's in a time structure. Okay, now that would seem irrational. If what it is about the environment, why does it matter? And it mattered at the time. It grew to matter less to articulate it into three different movements. And the way this was articulated was to close the lid of the keyboard at the beginning of each movement to indicate he would do nothing, and then open it at the end to indicate the possibility that he would play. And recall, you know, at the point when this piece was done, he had just, you know, been the person to premiere the Boulez Second Piano Sonata in the United States. He's a guy who can play anything. So to not play is kind of a huge constraint. So the question is, what is that kind of absorption where he's performing? He's on stage, you're in a concert, you have the conventions of the concert, but what he performs is his listening. Okay? And the reason why, and so in part that I was thinking through this in response to Ben Michaels, we'll get to Waterwalk, which was premiered actually in Milan in a moment. So I want to back up and explain where I am with this one moment. So at the time that Silence was 4 minutes and 33 seconds was written, all these guys are reading Antonin Artaud, because Boulez had mentioned Artaud. And what they're taking from Artaud is this notion of a theater of cruelty, this concept of a reconstituted theater. Where is my dad here? I just need to go and come up for of a reconstituted theater, which is not constrained or not subservient to language, and also is geometrically not on a proscenium. So now we can think, yeah, okay, so if you're not on a proscenium, well, that's a little bit like this kind of speaker arrangement, a radical antiphony. Okay. Oh, you're not subservient to language. Well, maybe that is analogous to not being subservient to pitch relations if you're working on a music based on noise. Okay? So they're very, very interested in this. But it goes further to Artaud's notion of a theater of cruelty. And I'll read this little passage. Rachel Rosenthal is a performance artist who is very, very close to Cage and Tudor, but based in California, who talks about this concept of a theater of cruelty in the following way. When you do something with such dedication that you are caught up in its wheels and just have to do it, and it's very difficult, and yet you have that sense of responsibility to the art. So this kind of intensity. So closing the lid on the piano, I would argue, has to be understood as the theater of cruelty. Now, there's another piece to this, and which is Artaud's writing. You know, he only directed one play. He was basically a theoretician. Even though he despised language, he generated, you know, thousands of pages of it. Okay, or didn't despise it, obviously, but felt that it was not a necessary basis for theater. One of the things in Artaud is it's all about shock and awe, overwhelming the audience. And you can think of overwhelming the audience as an authoritarian overtone. So the flip side, and in theater the flip side, would be Bertolt Brecht and this idea of distancing that leads to a kind of critical examination of what's going on. Okay? So when I close the lid on the piano and open it to whatever sounds are happening, that's a very minimalist version of shock and awe, right? It's like, oh my God, everything else. Or we can listen down the hall and so forth. But when I make a section out of it by reopening, the piano lid and say, oh, stop listening, we're done. Okay, I've made a distancing move. And so my argument is that experimental music involves a whole series of different distancing procedures. And those become, in a sense, where the composition lies. That is the composition, that distancing procedure. Now, this is all kind of heady, and what I'm going to do is, I'm going to jump to this and then go back to look at Waterwall. So this is a piece by Tom Johnson called 88s. The way it works is, each note on the piano is played once. And if you look at this notation, for example, the top one and the bottom one, it's clear, you'll see there's a little ellipsis, three dots. Because what that does is it essentially gives you one cell of an iteration that the performer performs to complete the piece. Right? And so the piece, I'll just start playing it. Hello, I'll try to start playing it. There we go. No. Oh, no, you know what? I have to pause here. Get this, somehow this got unplugged, I lost my audio. Here we go. Good enough. Now let's see if this is going to work for me.
There are 88 keys on the keyboard of a modern piano. And since 88 is divisible by 2, 4, 8, 11, 22, and 44, there are a number of ways that the 88 keys can be divided up into similar groups or modules. In the following little pieces, called 88s, each key is used once and only once, and the keyboard is broken up into modules, a little like what mathematicians refer to as tiling patterns.
Thank you. Okay, so the three different comments. One is, okay, we have this distancing of this very, and distancing is a part of any kind of musical form, right? Somehow you have a structure that imposes itself, and you begin to hear that articulated. So what's charming about this piece, I think, is it brings back all the old-fashioned values of attending to sonata form in this funny, smaller permutational scheme, right? And then the permutational scheme, the tension between its logic of the 88 keys and the tonal logic of a 12-note repetition. So, you know, you end up having the, you know, these major sevenths because that's 11, a major third because that's a four, stacked fourths because they conveniently tile, and so forth and so on. Also, that the piece, it's played okay, but, you know, Tom Johnson's not a particularly spectacular pianist, but that's kind of great. There's something about the inclusion of explanation that provides it with what I would describe as a nerdy fire, but also echoes back to those images that Bonsiere is talking about, that this thing that is not the perfect performer emerges, which is a you know, kind of a figure of human engagement with a mathematical formalism that in its ideal quality, you know, has this ideal perfection.
Because the piece is for tape, it's not for...
No, it's played live.
Yeah, but so it includes the explanation of the...
Oh, absolutely, yeah. Yes. It's part of the score is you say these things.
But you can perform it live, but you have to...
Oh, you do, it's performed live.
Yeah.
It's not for tape,
Okay.
And his point is that he wants the performer to be able to play the algorithm. Right, he's not going to notate it out. And I think there's one of the really good reasons for that is it's just like playing, you know, playing any kind of music based on, that's improvisational, like any music based on changes. You don't, if you need to know the structure and internalize the structure and enact the structure, not enact one specific articulation of that structure. In this case, the articulation is fixed, but still, playing from that makes a big difference. Now I'm going to go back, hopefully. Let's see this. So this is, I'm going to zoom. Oh no, this is not where I want to be. I want to be here, and, oh, goodness gracious. Here we go. This is a performance of Water Walk. This piece was actually premiered at the time Cage did Fontanamex in the Milan radio studio at Luciano Berio's invitation. And this is a performance on a TV show called I've Got a Secret. Now, part of the reason why I'm going to play this for you, first of all, it's interesting just because you can see how meticulously rehearsed the piece is, that there is this sense of the choreography being very, very carefully done. But I also want you to watch for how many things are not working right in the piece. The radios, there's like six radios in the piece, they weren't plugged in because there was a union dispute. So the whole sound concept in the piece is to have all these radios blaring, So he slaps the radios, and then you'll see he pushes the radios off the table. Now let me say, at the time of doing this piece, doing this performance, Cage was not a man of any substantial financial means. How he had been making his living much of the time in the years prior was collecting wild mushrooms for elite restaurants in New York while living up in study hall. He was not getting any commissions for his composition. He might get invitations to lecture, okay, or to appear, but that was sort of it. So there's some substantial commitment there, but you also see there's a blender. The blender jams, and later on you'll see smoke coming from the blender. You'll see he has a duck, and he, you know, it's supposed to make a little quack, and he plays it twice in the score. It never makes a sound. And my argument is, all of that actually has almost no impact on the effectiveness of the piece. And so I want to then ask after that.
But the Tribune takes him seriously as a composer, and this as a new art form. Inevitably, Mr. Cage, these are nice people, but some of them are going to laugh. Is that all right?
Of course.
I consider laughter preferable to tears.
Nice man. All right, let's show the in school a panel, first of all, so we can get full tilt for our cameras. Will you pull the desk back, please? Sorry about that.
I have a class is more valuable. I have an idea about the radios. Instead of turning them on, as I was written to do, I will hit them every time I turn them on, and I'm supposed to turn them on.
Well, now let me say this. The audience doesn't know what we're talking about.
Okay.
Let me say this. So Mr. Cage has consented to play this composition not as it was written, because a few hours before airtime, a jurisdictional union dispute arose between two unions as to who had the jurisdiction of plugging in the five radios. It has not been resolved as of right now, and so Mr. Cage has consented to do this, provided I make the announcement that the two unions came to a dispute and couldn't tell.
Well, I decided to, instead of turning them on, as I would normally, I will hit the top of each radio instead. That will produce the sound sometimes. Then when I turn them off, I will knock them off the table.
I'm with you, boy. All right, let's see this.
Oh, let me just make a comment here. In the lecture on nothing, Cage invites the listeners to join an organization he's founded called Capitalists Incorporated, in parentheses, so you won't think they're communists. And what you're asked to do so is to either destroy 100 records or 10 record players. So his, you know, he had this antipathy to recording as a replacement for musical performance. Not an antipathy to recording as a technique that's a need to use, but to the idea of recorded musical performances constituting musical performances. So, very, very ideologically insisting on live performance, which is why live electronics become important and so forth and so on. Okay, let's actually see this piece.
Great. Thank you. That's it. The title of the composition is what, Mr. Cage?
Water Walk, because it contains water and because I walk during its performance.
That's bigger, isn't it? Now, also, two things I want you to notice. Over here, Mr. Cage has a tape recording machine, which will provide much of the... We've put the machine so we can know where it is, which will provide much of the background. Also, he works with a stopwatch. The reason he does this is because these sounds are in no sense accidental in their sequence. They each must fall mathematically at a precise point. So he watches his watch as he works. He takes it seriously. I think it's interesting. If you are amused, you may laugh. If you like it, you may buy the recording. John Cage and Water Walk.
I don't like it. Slow down and chorus. It's never good. And The Lecture on Nothing is a lecture by Cage from the late 40s, which is actually all about time structure in music.
Is it the form?
Yes, it's read. And
okay.
I think I may have a PDF of it.
This one.
This is it, exactly. So you read it, I am here, and there is nothing to say. If among you are those who wish to get somewhere, let them leave at any moment. What we require is silence. But what silence requires is that I go on talking. Give anyone thought, a push, a
falls down easily.
So, and it falls into rhythmic structure. If you get towards the end, you'll see it goes on for 13 stanzas. It's like a 48-beat cycle of,
it's written here in the beginning.
The structure. So if we scan down here, whoops. Here we go. So it repeats over and over again. Here we are now at the beginning of the 13th unit, so we're changing it, of the fourth part. So it's pure duration. It goes on, and then there's two full 48-beat stanzas of nothing. He says, we're done. So he plays with this idea of using a lecture as simultaneously providing information and then enacting musical principle he's at work with. So, the stuttering interview with Avaluce that I was showing you is precisely a successor. It's following the footsteps of a lecture on nothing. Since he's asking about that, Robert Wilson, the director, had a beautiful little interview about, when he was asked about the lecture on nothing. He said, well, nothing. He said, so Robert Wilson, I went home to Texas, and I looked and I saw my niece in the living room. She was doing this. She was sitting on the floor, looking at the space between her fingers. And he said, I waited, and she'd been doing this for 4 or 5 minutes. And her mother came up. I said, stop. And he said, she got impatient and went in. So what are you doing? She said, oh, nothing. And he said, it's very difficult to do nothing. it's like perfect Wilson of this idea that that estrangement, is actually something that isn't necessarily estranged at all. It's the strangeness of discovery as well, right? I mean, like when you're little and you first start looking at the sidewalk, and it's like, oh my goodness, look at all this texture, these lines. What will I do in relation to these lines? And all those games come up. That's an analogous situation. So screens. So Dick Higgins is a Fluxus artist and composer and made these performance pieces. This one's very simple, it's just screens. Screen, 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 screen! And I could go on, and you would know that I'm not upset. Okay, so that's adsorption. Assembly, right? You know that I'm engaged in this physical activity. There is no particular, there's nothing specific I need to do, yet it can be both affective and non-affective simultaneously and become purely physical. Okay? So it's right in that space. Hannah Higgins, his daughter, she's an art historian now. And just this great story of when she was 4 years old. I remember coming down the stairs when I was about 4, and there was a group of people in our living room. I came around the corner just as my father started the piece, the stage music, and it was existential. It was like watching a parent being sawed in half. It's a really strange combination of the real and the not real. Now, there's a couple of things I want to comment on here. One is, so even if you're 4 years old, you can completely navigate this as this, what I'm describing as adsorptive relation. The other is, children don't see a lot of contemporary art or hear a lot of contemporary music. But children are learning all the time off YouTube. Okay, so there's this interesting problem for all of you as composers, or as artists and composers, as cultural beings, that here we have this fantastic, rapidly emerging instructional structure, called network media or social media. And we have no clue as to how to assist it in channeling it in truly productive ways. And corporate interests, if you go and look at research on this, you'll see everything is about virality. Because what they're really interested in is maximizing the number of quote-unquote eyeballs in relation to this situation. I actually think, I started researching this. This would be a great project. Maybe somebody has a thought of how to do it, we could team up. Which is to have basically some kind of web scraper that what it does is it looks, keep it on YouTube for the moment. It could be Reddit, it could be Vimeo, but YouTube is kind of easy to say. What it looks for is keys that have significant use, but not overwhelming use, and most importantly, have sustained use. In the thought that those might be places where subcultures are forming. I'll come back to that, that idea in a moment. Okay, so first, this idea about screens. So Gregory Whitehead's a radio artist, sort of sound artist, and he did this piece in a residency in Australia where he was on radio a lot talking about his Institute of Screenscape Studies. And so he had a telephone answering machine set up where people could dial in their screens to contribute to the study.
Hi, I'm Amelia Mangan. I'm 8 years old, and here's my screen. Bye.
Hello, Mr. Whitehead. It's approximately 4 p.m. Saturday afternoon, October the 19th. No two people cry the same way. I wonder whether this could apply to screens as well. You should know by now. I may do some research on that. Meanwhile, to add to your screenscape.
Screaming is a part of my dreaming. It happens only at night.
And I grew again.
This is what I think of your stupid, wanky scream idea.
He went to every record store in and around Manhattan and left off a survey to ask the people working there for their favorite recorded screen. One little irony, and then he made an LP out of the snippets of all their favorite recorded screens. One of the ironies, of course, of this project is by the time the record was out, maybe about half of those record stores were out of business. Because, of course, this is the moment, the total die-off of the record selling business, which is reviving because of the resurgence of vinyl to some extent. And so here's a little bit of it. It's an LP. Let's notice again that this again has this idea of a kind of formalism. Here's one of these surveys. Okay, he simply puts them on the record in the order that the responses are received. So there's a way in which you can only hear them as specimens. They're emphatically not composed together with a continuity in mind, only with a mapping. Okay? So the Gregory Whitehead tape,
well,
okay.
Come from other side.
Right, what's all the screaming about? Right. With the Gregory Whitehead, okay, that's assembled, and it's assembled to be witty and to be, you know, in a particular continuity. So kind of that tape is more composed. But the fundamental relation that's set up has exactly the same property. And what I would like to argue is that one thing about this kind of use of a distancing framework, of a simple, explicit, you know, disciplining framework, myself, is that it invites participation. It's easy to participate because you simply have to find your way of enacting the rule. Oh, I'll contribute a screen. Oh, yeah, don't get fooled again. It crops up like four times. The who wins, it's only on that record. Whatever it is. And so that makes this transition.
Actually, the phone call was actually perhaps the easiest participation.
Yes.
You just
call up and scream. Yeah.
Yeah.
Here's now a typical example of something that's truly YouTube participatory culture. This guy is going to teach you how to vocal fry scream.
It's a very difficult process. It's going to take a lot of practice. Once you have that breath down, all you have to do is be able to make that sound without the breathing at the beginning. You don't want to do every scream as, because that's going to sound like crap. You want to be able to start your scream right at the beginning, just start off, and it's going to be a little airy. It's going to sound like, you know, soda burps. Like, you know, as long as you practice up with that, you get to more, more tone. Hear the tone. Don't think you're in the tone. High screams are technically the same exact thing as the mid-range and the low, but it feels very different. And if you try and make the high scream where you're feeling it in your throat, bad news. It's gonna sound like crap, number one. Number two, it's gonna hurt you really bad. When you think of a high scream, you wanna try and think of it, instead of the sound coming, you can see my hand. Instead of the sound coming from your throat and out, you want to think of it as if the sound is coming from your head and going like that. Whoosh! It should feel kind of like the sound's coming from the roof of your mouth. You'll make the same sound as your mid-range, but you'll take it up there. Take it up to the ceiling, man. Okay, this next part's going to be loud, so turn your sound down, like, for a minute. And when you make this high scream, you have it bounce off the roof of your mouth, and it sounds kind of like, yeah! We're gonna go straight from high screams to mic etiquette. Right now I have my trusty AKG WMS. It's wireless, it's not plugged in right now, so if I turn it on, nothing happens. But,
okay, I'm on. So there's a whole world, of course, of instructional videos by professionals and by amateurs on YouTube for basically any kind of performance practice.
Makeup.
That's what it means.
Makeup is fantastic. Oh. They spend time like
I haven't actually looked at that.
Oh, they're marvelous. They're absolutely marvelous.
Okay, so
also because they keep the face half unmade.
Oh,
the other
brilliant.
Just marvelous.
Okay, so wait a minute. So what other, are there any other instructional video addictions that you're aware of? Like anything else that you find particularly compelling that you're aware of?
Beatboxing also.
Oh yeah, sure.
Beatboxing.
Guys,
what
else? Like, what is your secret YouTube viewing habit? No, I'm seriously interested in this because I find out stuff that I'm completely unaware of. And let me comment. You're back to the neoliberal business. It is absolutely in the corporate interest of Google to prevent you from having a comprehensive overview, of having YouTube be something that you wander through in this way. I think part of it is technological, that it's so much stuff, it's hard to keep track of. But the only tool they really provide is, you know, search keys. And you have to come up with a search key. So I really think that there's something about it being never fully recognized. There's no high point from which you can see the whole contour.
Yeah. So they don't want you to go there and take it all.
Right, right. They want you to have to come back repeatedly in small doses. But anything? Come on, I need one more good YouTube channel.
Well, you know, kitchen recipes, of course.
Yeah.
And you're answering the questions. Shut up. Come on, somebody. Got a standoff. The good, the bad, and the ugly.
So what else?
What was the last YouTube video or last video you watched online? How about that?
I follow web marketing lessons.
Web marketing lessons?
Web marketing.
Oh yeah.
C'è un video dove ci sono 20 differenti tipologie di urlo del genere metal.
Sì.
20 different typologies of heavy metal screaming.
Oh yes, exactly. Totally. Yeah, yeah, that's exactly, yeah. Wow, 20 is impressive, because the ones I've seen are like 4 or 5. Okay, so that's screams. And so you can see that it goes from this idea of Artel, well, nobody knows how to scream. A scream is essentialized. To a scream,
essentialized.
The scream as a an involuntary scream, if you will, to a scream as something highly elective, subject to different kinds of manipulation and learning how to enact those manipulations.
Yeah. And also aesthetics. You say, oh, that's bad.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
That's
and
good.
Then all his hand gestures are so great. And then it's so wonderful. That then there's like the kid thinking, oh, I'm gonna look in the mirror, you know, that he doesn't have a stage. The fact that he doesn't have a stage craft fully together is much of the charm. And that charm, of course, is right back to Ranciere and the teenager on the beach. It's the same thing happening. Okay, and I'm going the wrong way. Oh, I keep on going the wrong way. What's going on here? Here we go. So paper. So Ben Patterson was one of the few African-American participants in the Fluxus movement. And he made this piece, you know, early on, which is just for paper, 5 performers. You can see this is very much, you know, sort of a composed piece in this way, all about material, the possibility of an alternative material sound. 15 sheets of paper per performer, Fluxus size in the standard newspaper, quality vary, newspaper, tissue paper, like cardboard, and so forth. 3 paper bags, procedure, a general sign from the chairman, so there's a sort of not called a conductor, like John Zorn called a prompter, there's some kind of coordinating influence. Within the following 30 seconds, performers enter at will. By each performer, 7 sheets are performed. Each performer previously selects a range of ideas in the sequence of events. Shake, break, tear, twist. So here's, I'll just show a little bit of, this is somebody from Zeitkratzer doing a piece. Now, of course, it's intended to be multiple people. So what we have here is a little bit of, you know, minimalist retake on the idea is very much part of, you know, kind of a particular aesthetic going on, particularly in Berlin, actually. We can think of Michael Tesoro as a composer who's sort of very involved with that as well. A Vondelweiser group doing very, very deliberate, highly spaced performances, a lot of ma, to use the Japanese word for appreciation of space. Very post-caging in that way. Christian Wolff was even moved to say, well, it's interesting as a collective, but of course, in fact, in his lecture, he's saying, the experimental music hasn't had a new idea in a long time. And so you can get this idea of how, a little bit like Tom Johnson does, these pieces kind of unfold in a way where they accumulate meaningfulness in their variety. That you observe a constraint and then you kind of get rewarded by attending to that constraint by discovering how much is actually there. So it's sort of like endless A-B comparison of loudspeakers. You know, in a sense, is part of the listening relationship you put in. That's a kind of listening relationship that Benjamin would call testing, you know, in the work of art and the age of mechanical reproduction. And you can think of it as, well, it's inherently experimental, right? That you're making these comparisons. Taki Sakasugi, Japanese composer, kind of rises in roughly the same time period, early 60s, in the Japan Fluxus movement. This is a great piece to do. I mean, you know, everyone should do this at some point. You take a microphone, take a large sheet of paper, pick paper that's going to re-expand after you fold it, you have the microphone on, you wrap the microphone, and then you leave the gain up, or even turn the gain up, so that if you do this in a performance, if it's in the right situation, the kind of symbolic violation of the microphone by wrapping it on paper induces laughter. Then there's this moment, okay, I've been entertained, what I would describe as this post-coital moment, where then the paper starts to pop out and you're completely happy just listening to the paper unfold. And so, and that incidentally, so here's Kasugi doing it. I'm not that wild about this particular performance. I think the tech is in a way too perfected. Of course, with pieces like this and Back to Ma and Silence, they're also very porous. So inevitably, when you're hearing a piece like this, you start noticing the piano next door, the singer singing next door, the sound of the fan, everything else that's going on. And that idea, okay, is central, like another one of these central operations. So yes and now, Tony, I don't have this set up in the talk. I can play this a moment for you. Makes this argument that he asks the question, well, what does it mean to record 4 minutes and 33 seconds? So, well, it's not to record the sound in a room. Because what 4 minutes and 33 seconds is about is redirecting the normal function of a concert situation. Like, that's what it really does. It's a redirecting of attention. And it says, well, so you can't really do that with a CD because all you have is code. And so what he did, he had these early CD players that didn't mute when they were in error states. And then he'd ruin the CDs, sometimes just like a little piece of tape, which would cause them then to miscue, misscatter, and it generates this enormous electronic din. And Tone is about 5 feet tall. So this gentle, very sweet man sitting at the edge of a table with two little CD players and doing tap. And all hell breaks loose. Tap! And all hell breaks loose. They did a concert, a performance where I teach. And the space has these two very large glass windows on either side. So it's really loud. And, you know, there's an audience. But as the piece went on,
students started to accumulate at the window trying to figure out what the heck was going on. It was very beautiful, right?
What's the name?
Wounded CD, solo for Wounded
CD. But what's the name of the composer?
Yasunao Tone.
Dentro la violina.
So he is a friend, I mean, sort of an associate of Kosugi's also, who are kind of the same period. You know, part of this group that was influenced by... So you would say tone in English, but it's tone. Okay, now, autonomous sensory meridian response, or ASMR. This is a full bore internet cultural thing. What happens is people make videos, and if you search ASMR, you'll find hundreds of these online, and they're of little crinkly sounds or whispering. The idea is somehow this induces a tingling response in some listeners. And so I actually have a student who's been researching this, and she actually, well, I'll play a little bit of this video. This will be an example of it. Many of the videos, but by no means all of them, there's a huge argument that some of these videos seem to have a sexual connotation, sexual overtone, and the ASMR, people who are serious about ASMR say, no, 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 it is not that at all, and those are kind of a problem within this. So you have lots of images where the camera is shot on a woman with cleavage very prominent whispering into the camera. So it almost seems like some kind of very, very innocuous phone sex. But that is not what people who are involved with this insist. They're quite passionate that it is not that. But this is what the table means. Just the sound of paper crinkling for 30 minutes. And if you look at comments and what goes on in relation to them, it will be, oh yeah, this really worked for me, I'll play it when I need to go to sleep, or I need to relax. So what's happening here is you've got this strange piece of auditory culture that's got an audience, and members of the audience have expertise, full command, not in an aesthetic sense, but in a symptomological sense. Does this trigger ASMR for me or not?
What is ASMR?
So the idea is it's this tingling response that sometimes people call head orgasms, although they don't like that terminology, but it induces an intense tingling response from that sound. And there's...
So they like it.
Oh, totally, yes. Now, the interesting thing is, so I have this one student who's totally great, who has a little bit of ASMR response and then got curious about that society. She made a piece, which she calls Trashgan. It's a large, sort of as if an Afghan, a large blanket, made of materials appropriate for doing ASMR sex, so magic bark or crinkle and so forth. And what she's done is she's contacted one of the people making these kinds of videos with the most hits, and asked her if she would make a video with her trash can, which she's agreed to do. So this to me is a very, very interesting strategy, because it's a compositional intervention of a sort, right? I mean, she's created the material for the piece, but she is not a part of the ASMR world, and would think it would be too parodic, or it would just be wrong for her to try to make an ASMR video. But to make this and then, you know, offer it up or insert it into this situation becomes kind of her performance work. So you can see, so here's this world. There are many listeners. There are listeners. That's not music. It's not within a musical category. Yet it can be easily described. If you believe that music is simply, you know, sounds ordered in time, it's music also. But the cultural formation around it is something else.
So this is an example, you know, like maybe the clearest example of how there can be this really transformed situation that all of you, as musicians and composers, might want to keep a weather eye on to see if it exposes some possibility for your own auditory imagination for intervention. But so it just goes on like this indefinitely, right? So that's quite extraordinary. And you can think for a moment that this can only happen through social media. There is no other way for this to become some kind of an entity. And let's say it's arising in a way you can trace this back to the collectives forming around HIV and researching and sort of pulling, feeling that the medical establishment isn't actually benefiting them enough and taking it on for themselves. Because the ASMR community regards this as a symptom, a real symptomology that is not given, is not recognized by medical authorities. So they are creating their own investigation of it.
Okay, is this considered a disease?
No, it's not a disease, it's just a phenomenon. But they consider it something they want to understand. Mm-hmm. So you can go to Reddit and find, you know, several different big ASMR groups. With their own articulation. Okay, so I'm going to end with beds. First bed is the Robert Rauschenberg. It's a famous painting of this bed. He literally takes his bedspread pillow, puts it up on the canvas. There's a hidden story here in that the pillowcase is marked with kind of a calligraphic like sign Twombly. The bedspread is marked with the colors of Jasper Johns, and it's the moment when he's in a kind of lover's triangle with Cy Twombly and Jasper Johns. So, you know, so this ends up about information hiding, okay? That the painting has all these other discursive issues going on, right? I've got materiality, the assemblage, why canvas, a joke about flatness, you know, all of this stuff is going on that's all within this visual art discourse. And then there's this other layer, which is also co-present, and if you know enough, you would intuit, or you would see, or wouldn't, okay? And this is a characteristic of lots of these pieces. So for example, George Brecht is a piece where you simply take apart your instrument and pack it up. And there's a story that his father, who was a professional clarinetist, was in some kind of concerto situation with a particularly impossible diva, and basically had a nervous breakdown and did just that, just took apart his instrument and left. And so, you know, it's a recollection of that, but not that would not be an order of information. So John Lennon and Yoko Ono, their idea is they're trying to figure out how to deal with celebrity while essentially pursuing a fluxus strategy. Okay, and if you go and look at those videos, it's really interesting because they're rendered unintelligible. If you know about Fluxus, everything that they're doing is completely familiar. There's nothing particular, and it's sweet, you know, and you know, it's an anti-war statement. But you can see that because of the scaling, because of the sort of the exposure there, it's just not allowed to be intelligible in the culture of 1969. Now today, we have Angelina Jolie and Brad Pitt. And because, I'm looking here and pointing here, it hasn't gotten there. Here they are. They were able to sell the first photo of their child for $7 million that all went to UNICEF. Okay? So what they're able to do within a logic, within a neoliberal logic of capitalism, said, well, look, paparazzi are going to want images of this kid. So what we're going to do is we're going to actually do some good with it. Okay, but the good, and let me point out that part of the problem here is the good is rendered completely anonymous by going to UNICEF. The good that Lennon and Ono were trying to do was to actually change thinking. Here, there's no premise of changing thinking. say, well, that's impossible, so we'll do this other thing. So this, I think, could be construed as a kind of neoliberal aesthetics, right? And in their position, and I would say it can be construed as that without any stigma, because in their position, that's all they can do. Oops. Now, the next image I'm going to show you, slowly, another line from here. What I'm going to do is I'm going to stand over here, and then I can advance, look back, and you can see it early on. This is a piece by Mel Chin. Mel Chin is a sculptor. He had a student of his who worked as a prop mistress on a popular television show called Melrose Place.
Sapete che cos'è un prop mistress? Quello che dà, the props are the
so a prop scenery. Scenery, what's on the set of the television show? And who decides what
it is? Che dà le stampelle, le cose, cioè quello che appare nella...
Di chi è questo?
Yes, can you write it down?
Oh, prop mistress?
No, the name of the...
Oh, Mel Chin? This piece called In the Name of the Place. So, the deal here is he would sneak these props onto the show. One got identified, which was a parody of a Stolichnaya vodka advertisement, but in the image of the Oklahoma City bombing, which at that time, this is back in the 90s, it was this horrific attack by a right-wing terrorist in the United States.
Unabomber.
No, it wasn't the Unabomber, but it was it was much, because this actually destroyed a major office building early on. So then this got exposed to the producer, Aaron Spelling, but he was able to sell the producer on the idea of actually doing this as a project, because he had a show coming up at the Museum of Contemporary Art. So this is a bedspread, and if you notice, that image there is of condoms. And condoms were not allowed to be shown on television.
No,
the condoms were forbidden imagery. And so here's how this actually would play out.
Please.
I thought morning was your favorite time.
Any morning but this one.
So they're completely wrapped in condoms.
Our plot to bring Bobby down.
Okay, so...
The last minute is really...
There's a dress around because it's worth getting the actual movement times.
Thank you.
So, if you remember back at the beginning, it was talking about absorption and theatricality. My remark is there's a wonderful word, adsorption, which comes from biology and physics. It has to do with when you have a cell, if it absorbs something, it goes and fills in the cell itself. If it adsorbs, it stays around the membrane, around the outside of the cell. And so, my view is that all of these pieces, the Tom Johnson, Cage, 4 minutes and 33 seconds, all are involved with adsorption, in the sense that what happens is you are very aware of an external formal imposition, a material imposition that's being made. There's a rule being followed. Okay? There isn't a rule being followed when you're reading the manuscript. There's other kinds of social rules that are articulated when you're washing the floor in the Mies van der Rohe Institute, but that's different. Here, people are enacting these very specific rules in very specific ways. And so that is this adsorption. When you go to listen to the piece, when you go to observe the performance, you find yourself asking something about that those constraints, as well as what you hear, and you move back and forth. So the Tom Johnson reveals that, I think, in a very beautifully traditional way, in that you become acquainted with, oh yeah, the sound world of just 88 notes, and now how it gets quickly exhausted if you're playing four notes at a time, how it can be sequenced, how it can be subdivided. And so you're very much aware of that at the same time as you have a specific encounter with each different variation. In the case of this with Cage, and the other word instead of theatricality is performativity. This is a totally theatrical piece. It's conceived for TV. It's definitely thought of to involve, you know, entertaining Dada juxtaposition or surrealist juxtaposition, you know, in terms of the materials. But what is absolutely crucial, and what Cage practiced for weeks before he would decide to actually do the piece on television, was the execution. So because so much is about the execution, the fact that the grinder, that the blender breaks down, the fact that the duck call doesn't sound, is actually not significantly material. And we know this from music. It doesn't matter if you make a mistake, you know, in the midst of a performance. If the performance is going well, it's immediately forgiven. Okay, so there's a kind of prissiness to the theatricality and absorption opposition that isn't really in this work. And this matters to me, first of all, to sort of, okay, sort of identify this idea. My joke about it is, okay, Alcoholics Anonymous. The 12 steps. One of them is you accept a power greater than yourself. And what's inherent in all of these pieces is precisely that, that there's some principle that makes determinations so that what happens at time, chance in this case, you know, the mathematics of the particular telling of the other, and what happens because of that is the willfulness of the composer is present on a meta level, but not on a moment-by-moment level. It's somehow attenuated, pushed aside, or eliminated. And that, so what happens then is you're both aware of this, hey, it's invented, it's manipulated, it's something made, and at the same time, within that situation, there's the possibility of innocent encounter. Okay? That's analogous to the photo of the kitchen, the photo of the teenage girl in Poland, where something else emerges as well, and they're co-present. And what I would argue is that this is one of the central preoccupations of this whole period of art making and music making both. Now, maybe one last, because this is highly entertaining, and maybe then I can go on and actually get to YouTube and the web, but I don't want to, you know, completely, I'm not sure how exhausting or non-exhausting this is for you. Let's see. So this is a videotape of tribute to John Cage at the point of his 60th birthday. And this is Alvin Lucier expounding on 4 minutes and 33 seconds. Whoops, it would have been had I pressed the right button, which I did not manage to do. Let's see. Wait a minute, I'm getting the wrong, oh, 6:21.
Perspective. And it was actually August 29th, 1952,
that
David Tudor, the famous pianist who now, of course, has become a famous composer in his own right, performed the piano piece 4 minutes and 33 seconds in the Averick Auditorium up in the town of Woodstock. And that being a very historic moment, and of course carrying much more artistic and historic weight, we should really, to be perfectly frank, regard that as the first authentic Woodstock, and that the Woodstock that just occurred, you know, 500,000 human beings sitting in the mud under the hot sun for all those days really isn't as important as that historic piano performance.
So the idea here is Alvin stutters, but he's electing to not try to control his stutter. Okay, so he's been, and maybe you didn't, people didn't laugh, so maybe they didn't quite get the lines. So he's saying, 4 minutes and 33 seconds was done at Woodstock. Therefore, that's Woodstock and this rock festival with all these people in the mud, you know, set it aside. So it's performing a parody of the pedantic professor, but pedantic professor who keeps on locking these sounds. And so what I'm trying to illustrate here is how this adsorptive strategy allows total farce as well. I mean, it can be completely impure, yet it still happens. And part of what happens is you are confronted with this moment where you have to decide to accept the stutter on different grounds. It stops being a speech impediment. It stops being a moment of embarrassment to being almost the point of the entire interview exchange. That transition where you have to kind of reorganize your thinking is exactly what the experimental project is about. And so what happens through the 60s and 70s in particular is one composer after another finds a way to challenge an assumption, eliminate the assumption, and consequently create an entirely alternate ontology for their music. So Lamont Young doing a drone and saying, oh, you know, if you listen to this drone, after a while you start hearing all sorts of stuff. That's completely antithetical to Cage's very post-Darmstadt model of sound as a vector of attributes that happen to be chance determined. They could be serially determined some other way. It's a total challenge to that that he embraces. He says, this is doing something very similar in a very different way. Pauline Oliveris's idea of deep listening, or its earlier form of the of sonic meditations, to locate the musical practice completely in disciplined listening practices would be an analogous, you know, rupture. Max Neuhaus, going to the notion of environmental deployment of pieces on a permanent or near permanent basis. Again, it's a total transformation of where this music sounds, how it sounds, and how the listener is going to confront it. And that set of issues are what they're on about. So that's sort of a moment for a pause. And then what I can do is, because I appreciate, you know, taking this time to go through three different examples of artistic practices that then how a transfigured version of them appear in relation to social media. Screening, paper, and beds. So that's what we'll be, but maybe here's a moment to take a pause or ask if there are any questions. So what I've been trying to do here is to set up what I mean by experimentalism in order to use that as that's the tool I'm trying to use to think through what's going on in these cultural productions and social media. And when we look at these examples in screens, beds, and paper, we'll see first experimental versions and then versions that clearly relate yet are quite different in relation to YouTube.
Ci sono domande? Adesso facciamo una pausa, non so se la vedete. State capendo? No, no, it's the problem is the language, but
yes.
But okay, screaming paper and what's the third?
Screaming paper and beds. Bed.
Bed. Letti.
Think of John Lennon.
John and Yoko.
Oh no, bed.
Okay, well, I have a question about the cage.
Yeah.
Besides the fact that it's really beautiful, it's really absolutely marvelous. But how can you say that things didn't work out? That the duck that didn't squeak actually wasn't intended. It's actually difficult to say that.
Well, I mean, I think.
The blender that jams and smokes. Actually, that's fantastically.
If you look at the notation of Waterwalk, I mean, it's their duck call here. So he wouldn't choose a duck that didn't squeak as the instrument. So the failure of the duck to squeak is a failure of the instrument. I mean, if there is.
Is a mistake in the performance. It's actually.
Well, yeah, it's a mistake or a problem in the performance. Sure, absolutely. Mm-hmm. Absolutely. But it's porous to that, just like. And so the viewpoint, and you know, this is so you can use this kind of Buddhistic language, right, of multi-centeredness and interpenetration. Actually, it's a beautiful story. I'll come back to a beautiful story about that kind of phraseology. So that there's the piece that he's trying to do, and there's the piece that happens. And the piece that happens from that viewpoint isn't seen as a reduced version of an ideal, because the ideal doesn't exist. What exists is a set of procedures for going about doing the piece, and this is how it happened. And here's a version of this. There was a talk given. There's a project in New York called the Buddhism Project. There's a bunch of galleries looking at the influence of the interest in Buddhism on American artists. And they had this lecture, this woman, and she was going on about how Buddhism was the one religion, unlike Islam, unlike Christianity, unlike Hinduism, that didn't result in violence to others. Okay? Now, in point of fact, now in Myanmar, you have violence to others in the name of Buddhism, so that's not even totally correct. But a Roshi, from the Staten Island Zendo raised his hand. So he's a practicing Zen Buddhist. I said, well, the problem with that statement is I can never say that as a Buddhist. Which is to say, that idea of an attribution and a hierarchy based on your point of view immediately fails to enact the fundamental relationality that Buddhism conceives. So to take on the mantle of Buddhism is much, and what was beautiful about it is all these curators suddenly realizing, oh, this is much harder than I thought it was. That there's a way that if you want to investigate that, you can't, your habits of enactment will prevent you from actually being able to engage it. And that becomes, you know, kind of one of, I think one of the problems with understanding a lot of this kind of work of like, well, why is it the way it is? That until you really consider the detail of the project, you know, it's not obvious. So that from the Buddhistic viewpoint, that's fine. That's what happened, period. Right? So that was sort of a long-winded way to get to what. So now, for example, there's this constant debate. I mean, I've gotten into arguments on the radio about this in relation to, say, cage pieces like harpsichord, that people feeling that they really need to do it the way it was done, where it's absolutely clear to me that Cage was a composer of notations. And those notations, once they're complete, they're freed of him. So as long as you follow through on what is specified in the notation, it'll be a legitimate realization. In that sense, he's a quote-unquote old-fashioned composer. There'd be plenty of other experimentalists where it would be easier to make the argument that no, you've got to kind of do what they were up to. But part of what's very interesting about Cage, for all his radicality, I mean, Tudor actually said this, that he came from a very conservative training, and that that's part of, you know, the model. So that there's a strictness there which is not well understood. And actually, I think is part of what gives that work much greater shelf life than people had anticipated, than many critics thought. Okay, so should I go on to screens? So no one in Europe knows how to screen anymore. This is a line of Anthony Arto. And so, of course, what he...
We'll leave it on a
Oh, gloss on who Arto is?
No. They want to have a pause.
Oh, I'm sorry. Okay, let's take a break. Okay, sure. Take five, take ten, take coffee, take a smoke.
Five.
Cheap. To get second thoughts.
The last minute is better. So what that's doing is playing with this issue of proxemics, of what is made immediately available and what is rendered unintelligible. Okay? And one of the challenges of the web is it presumes to render everything intelligible. So here's another performance piece. This is a student at Columbia University named Kerry Sulkowitz, who is protesting the decision of the university to let a fellow student who she feels engaged in a forcible sexual encounter with her to remain on campus. And so her decision of how to make this piece was to carry her mattress wherever she goes on campus for the remainder of her time at school. And there are these specific rules of engagement that she will carry it if someone offers to help her, she can accept, but she can't ask for help. Okay, so little stations of the cross, you know, there's a bunch of things going on, but also highly relational. And I don't have an image which I should have to make this point. So what happens, though, is this, which is a classic performance artwork. I mean, right out of the canon. Yoko Ono's famous cut piece. This is a piece, and you can find videos of this on YouTube, which she performed, I don't know, maybe five or six times, where she sits on a stage, there's a pair of scissors, and the instruction is cut, and you can cut away any little piece of her clothing. Okay. So, you know, that's in 1965, 66. So, you know, these are hardcore pieces about sexuality, about women's equality, possibly about general gender equality, about the gays. All of this is activated and within this framework. But now what happens on the web is this piece, which from my perspective is really about an individual encounter for somebody happening upon Karen hearing this. And first of all, deciding whether they're going to give it their attention. Okay, and to what extent they're going to help if she appears to need help. All of that about empathy and openness. All of that about a reconfiguration of your attention. Okay, gives way to a model of participatory culture where you have other groups at other universities, but there'll be 10 people carrying the mattress. And from my perspective, that's unfortunate in relation to the piece she's actually doing, because it takes all the poetry of the piece she's doing and instead renders it within the particular activating issue rather than the piece itself. Now that could be me being a fuddy-duddy, being like old and in the way in relation to the roles of participatory culture. But I think it helps mark the big questions here are, what is it? So fundamentally, like free software, to exist, it needs a user base, right? I mean, it can't survive without a user base, okay? So it's radically socialized. And it's socialized in a way that requires scaling. It requires multiplicity, it requires, quote unquote, the mass. This piece, as a performance, I think requires the individual unknown encounter. And so has a certain fragility in relation to the logic of creating a sociality around it. And it's unclear whether that's a good thing or a bad thing. And so all of this comes down to this point. Social media, all of this as it's available online, there seems to me to be two different ways this plays out. One is the archive, the encyclopedic archive. You can go to ubu.com. I totally recommend going to Ubu, incidentally. Put that up. That is a project of Kenny Goldsmith that basically has any documentation of the avant-garde he can find. If people ask him to take things down and they have their rights, he will. Otherwise, it's there. It's Ubu an extremely web. Useful... Ubu Web also. Ubu it's both ways. You can find it either way. Extremely useful. So that's one impulse, the archival, the encyclopedic. There's a nice book by David Grubbs about this in relation to free improvisation and experimental music, how what is now available to all of us as listeners is 100-fold greater than what's available to participants at the time of this forum. So that's one piece of it. So you can have everything at your disposal. The other piece of it is the creation of differing social groups, differing groups of listeners and participants on a pretty rapid fire and supple basis. So we can think of it this way. At one point, like I address all of you, I could write a letter to the editor. But now, I can address any arbitrary subset of humanity if I have their links. So that's a funny, different version of public address. It isn't to an unknown public, it isn't one-on-one, it isn't localized, and the participants in that may change of their own volition in various ways. So this creates an entirely different performative context. So performance here writ large. It doesn't mean playing the piano in front of people, but when you contribute to that, you're performing. they're performing for that group. What that means, or how we want to make sense of that, or how that can work in relation to musical practice, totally unknown. Final comment. All of this creates a negative space, the stuff that you just can't do in these frameworks, or the stuff that, like Mel Chin's piece, render themselves unintelligible in those frameworks. And it could be that that site is the one that's the most productive musically, or the most productive artistically. And it's that site that I was thinking about when I made this festival, Idiopreneurial Entrophonics, about analog synthesis and the resurgence of analog synthesis. Because analog synthesis inherently, absolutely doesn't have a apparent passage to an app or to a laptop. Many makers aspire to have an interface that is carefully designed so that a dial does only one thing. So you're never in the experience of the paged relationship that you have with virtually any other kind of software. I mean, some people do, some people don't. And so what I want to point to is one of the ways of understanding why there's so much activity and interest in these kinds of forms, and perhaps your own activity and interest, okay, is because it is responding to these issues that I've been outlining. That I see it as clearly being in a response. Not articulated as this, but so what I'm trying to do is provide an analytic framework where it can be understood as responding in that way. This evening, this performance I'm going to do, which is a piece in progress, is kind of about all of these issues, in that, on the one hand, it's something of a recapitulation of a piece by Robert Ashley, which is based on a strange book he found that was self-published in 1944 in Sarah Menken, Christ and Beethoven, There Were Men and Women. And this book is this one very interestingly odd sentence with names permutated throughout the sentence. So there's a total of 1,023 names in the entire text, and there's about 25 that get repeated. So Ashley got very interested in this and was making this piece, lost the master tape. The master tape he made was stolen from his car, and so it only exists as a recording. It was actually done on the Cramps label from Italy, Nova Musica. And in it, he reads each stanza in a single breath and then splices those stanzas together. He wanted to make a live piece out of it and wasn't able to work out how, and then sort of set it aside. So I got interested in this on several different levels. One is Bob just passed away, and I'd like to do something, you know, sort of in honor of Bob, who was a great influence. Two, the text itself in this encyclopedic recounting of names of significance to him in 1944 serves as a funny time capsule that also is a precursor of the web, you know, using biographical dictionaries, using these other resources. So the historical distance helps reveal things that I think is interesting. The third is, it occurred to me, one way to do this live is to simply have a recording process where the playback is slowed down slightly. So I just have it slowed down, but then pitch corrected back up, and then so I can read a text, read for a while, and then when I need to take a breath, I can stop recording, take my breath, wait for that to complete, and then punch back in. So the playback and my speaking are constantly doing this.
Okay.
Now, one of the things that happens when you do that, if you've ever tried to speak while listening to yourself on a delay, is it immediately creates speech impediments. That the moment you do that, you slow down your voice in order to try to maintain coordination where you can. But once the time delay gets great enough, you know, on the order of like a quarter second, then you're kind of freed from that desire to reconnect and you can march ahead. So I'm very interested in this idea of the, that is kind of a sonic allegory, actually. That there's a present, and it can be kind of like Maurice Merleau-Ponty, think of the present as a turbulence that throws things to the past into the future. Okay? And that this is playing with that turbulence. And that one of the problems of information media is the way they are now being presented to us is they put us in an eternal present that leaves us aphasic. And so this piece, which is still just under development, is trying to enact that in a way that can be heard. So the idea here as a compositional strategy is I'm trying to make a hearing experience that can resonate with a much broader, inescapable experience that we all share in relation to these devices. That's it. Thank you. So the TED here is as in a TED talk. Okay, and TED talks, which are this perfect packaging and encapsulation of different little things to be celebratory, positive bits of neoliberal culture. So in this piece, I'll begin by kind of presenting an analysis of some of the text, which is in part to facilitate listening, but it's also enacting that TED relation. This is something that I don't have figured out in terms of how to really do right. But my goal is to have it mash up so that a TED talk goes into becoming this strange recitation and moves back and forth between all the assertions of power and healthy body as part of a TED talk to this much more troubled space of the recitation of a Walcott text.
Okay. Sono domande.
I have a question. I didn't quite get what you were saying about the mattress piece, the girl.
Yes.
Yeah. Are you saying that actually it's a pity that, because you mentioned that it's a pity that it doesn't work, that is this, does this go on YouTube or?
Well, yeah, so let me do that. Let me see if I can find. So she made this piece and has been doing this piece, and it got a fair amount of press. And then what happened was other colleges, anti-rape activists took up the piece, but they would do it in the form of maybe 20 people together carrying the mattress. You see this image. Now, to my mind,
so that becomes how
well, it vulgarizes the piece. All the ambiguities of the piece, all the kind of balances of issues that she's very carefully working on are totally lost, and it becomes an enactment of the issue rather than an enactment of a whole series of different relations around that issue.
It's not fragile any longer.
Yeah, exactly. And that I just misspelled it there. Let's just see if we can get to. Yeah, like something like this. So Pound carried that weight, so it becomes a Twitter feed. Here. And so this becomes an entirely different thing, which is affirmative and celebratory rather than ambiguous and troubled. And that the logic of the web, this is like a TED talk, so it takes the piece of art and turns it into a TED talk.
Yeah.
And that circulation is, I think, one of the places that's probably the most troubling and interesting for artistic activity. I mean, one other thing about this, I remember back at the point when the wall had fallen and there was this thing about the end of history. I said, well, that's ridiculous. We've known since Rousseau that the interests of the state don't conform to the interests of individuals. And that so different formations come to articulate that need. And I actually said at that point, I feel proud that I said this. Somebody said, well, what would it be now? I said, well, maybe Islam. And guess what? It is. The story of the last 15 years has been a need for a different alternative, and that different alternative beautifully articulates within Islam. And so you get a radicalized Islamic fundamentalism, perhaps completely disfiguring Islam, but able to organize itself in that way. Okay, so all of these properties of affirmation that seem to be really built into these structures, okay, will build a deep discontent also. And as artists, as composers, as thinkers, thinking how to meet the needs of that discontent is a huge opening for a kind of cultural centrality and immediacy. You know, one of the things you gotta understand, we're now living in a multi-culture, right? There is no center. So there's no way that you can simply work on your own and have any reason to expect that that beautiful work that you've been doing will become an object of attention or even be understandable. But if you can find a way that the work you're doing on your own can resonate with issues of this sort that also already impact you, then there's that possibility. So I would say, I would strongly, my fundamental belief is that if you want to be a composer, if you want to be an artist, you have to look at the newspaper, that's in quotation marks, you have to look out as well as look in. And the problem is to find how what you see looking out, how you can render something that resonates with that when you look in. And that if you start working that way, it ends up giving you a feeling of confidence that you're doing something you need to do. And this goes back, I mean, Stockhausen said, I always feel so wonderful when I'm on the right track. Okay? and it's a little bit like that. And that I would argue that now, at that point, people would talk about that in terms of historic necessity, an evolution. Okay, so the idea is that you could get to that by thinking through the trajectory of the evolution of music up until that moment. Okay, well, the thing is, evolution works to greater complexity and greater simplicity simultaneously, not just greater complexity. And that evolution now is, in a, that idea, okay, is fundamentally troubled by the multiplicity of different frameworks that are co-present. So encountering that multiplicity, not denying it, asking either where there is something shared or how your relationship to it can work, is what you need to do to find a way to move forward with your own work that you can tell a story about to others that gives them a way to enter in. It's like the most efficient way to do that, would be my belief. So, you know, that's the argument for why it really, so for example, it's really interesting to think about what's relevant to what you're making that's completely outside of music. What's a story or an image you can tell that's outside of that sphere, because then that gestures to listeners who have no involvement with music. We're always involved with these processes that can be very technical and, in a sense, hermetic. The beauty of the laptop is it opened a door to many, many people encountering, you know, electronic processes that before weren't inaccessible to them. And it's enabled, you know, a real transformation in what constitutes popular music, what constitutes overlaps between popular and classical composition, okay? So there's a case in point. So the laptop scene of the early 2000s really completely transformed the world of electronic music. these other processes now, you know, have a kind of operatic scale. So think about it.
And that's it. Sorry.
Sermon over. Questions, or you're done in?
Well, these are all Lucier fans. I would expect more questions. About
I can tell you Alvin stories later. I mean, you know, because the thing about Alvin is that he's not particularly technologically adept, so he'd have to invent his own approach to thinking about the technology, and that's part of what makes those pieces so striking, that they're not working in the standard language. And, you know, a point I make about that work is it's often image-derived, which is he'll be fascinated by an image of some sort and then use that image to shape his choices. So it gives, this fact of information hiding, it ends up giving a unity to the piece that you can't quite identify, right? But so, for example, the staging of the piece then becomes extremely important. So, for example, still in Moving Lines, there's this idea that he'd have people or dancers walking along nodal lines in a standing rectangle, right? So you can hear, oh, it's quiet here, so I'm moving, it's quiet. And so this sort of image of people being led by their ears as they're walking. Now, the way you would normally do this, and often these performances would be a loss, is they'd sort of cross across the space. He did a show in a theater, and he had the thought, well, okay, the sounds are flowing out into the audience. So he had people move from upstage to downstage. And it was a horrible mistake, because if you have all these people doing this, and they're approaching you in that proscenium context, it becomes an invasion of the body centers, right? So the poetic of it, which is it's like a field of bison crossing over, you know, that somehow there's some principle that's organizing the flocking of these people, and that's what you're really trying to bear witness to, that ends up being lost because of all the repressed violence of the theatrical situation where you must pay attention to me. Right, all of that power struggle that's just inherent ends up being activated by moving downstage, by approaching the audience, where if they were to go across, it wouldn't. And so, interestingly, that's an example of that's like a totally subtle problem that only emerged, only became really intelligible at the moment of the show, and say, oh, I shouldn't have done it that way. And interestingly, it does tie back a little bit to this absorption and theatricality, because the image across, by not crossing the proscenium, not activating that in that way, enables the image, where descending this way is quote-unquote more theatrical. I mean, so there, it isn't that theatricality and absorption has no use. I don't think it's a good analytic tool for all these issues we've been talking about today. But that would be like one really good example. We all know about musicians who indicate, like who overdo it in performance, and that can be distracting and annoying, right? Theatricality certainly exists, and it can happen, you know, it can happen when you least expect it.
But this is like a more connotational issue. I mean, if the movie Invasion of the Body Snatcher hadn't been done, let's say, would that give the same?
Well, I think, I don't know. I mean, I think it has to do with the invisible wall. That a slow movement downstage is implicitly, you know, it carries with it the possibility that you would carry out into the audience. So if it's in a situation where things are happening everywhere, okay, so as Artaud envisions, then yeah, it's lessened. But if it's happening in a situation where things are confined to the stage, I think it would still carry it. so that we can't just blame it on Invasion of the Body Snatchers. We'd have to go back to, like, I don't know, the advent of subscription concerts in the beginning of the 19th century and the consequent silencing of audiences or something like that. I mean, you have to take it, I mean, it's a much, and it probably goes back to the Greeks, right? I mean, so that, and that just has to do with that you're because you believe you're being given a representation on stage. And so if you have the event on stage, you're involuntarily in dialogue with that tradition of representation.
Thank you.
Sure.
Thank you very much, Ron.
So thank you guys. You've been very patient. I hope it was understandable.
No.
They're very silent. I don't know why.
They might be
silent but thoughtful, we hope.
Shy. I hope so.